Well, good morning. Welcome to Clare. And I greet all of you, especially those from Ahori, Clare, and Finnecash Presbyterian Churches, in the name of our King and Saviour, the Lord Jesus Christ. At the very outset, I would like to say just a few things to you about our present circumstances, and specifically our inability to meet together. I have three exhortations for you before we go any further. Here they are. Firstly, rejoice. Rejoice that our Father is on his throne and that his government is holy, wise, and powerful. He is in control. Rejoice. Secondly, lament. Lament that we are unable to meet in person. We are unable to assemble for public worship. Many of the elements of public worship, preaching, praying, singing, and so on, are included in this recording. But we are not gathered. We are not assembled. So in the truest sense, this is not public worship. Let us therefore humble ourselves before the Lord and confess our sins, especially the sin of having an insufficient esteem of his ordinances and of the privilege of meeting together. Let us lament. Thirdly, give thanks. Paul Reeder is helping me again today with this recording. It is a mercy that we have this technology, that we have this opportunity to hear the Word of God in this way. That is a mercy. That is a blessing. Let us therefore also give thanks. So there you have three exhortations. Rejoice that our Father is on the throne. Lament that we are unable to assemble for public worship, and give thanks that we can still listen in these days to the Word of God in this way. Today we are going to continue our guided tour through the book of Revelation. Our tour is entitled The Lamb Wins, after the title of a little commentary on the book of Revelation written by Richard Bewes. Please turn with me in your Bibles, in your homes, to the beginning of Revelation chapter 4, and please do keep them open as we journey through to the end of chapter 7. As you're turning, I do want to thank Paul Reeder again for his help, and also the Mason, Ag, Fraser, Smith and Hart families for leading the praise from their own houses or from this meeting house at various times. Before we go any further, let's pray together. Let us pray. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Our triune God, we adore you this morning as the one living and true God. You are awesome and magnificent. You are stunningly beautiful in all your perfections. Give us a view, we pray this morning, of your throne. May we see you in your kingly majesty, and may we see our lives and our world as you see them. Forgive our unbelief, we pray. This greatest of all our sins, and be pleased, our Father, for Jesus' sake, to speak to us, to show to us the glory of your reign, the reality of your government, the glory, the wonder of your throne. Sovereign Lord, show us your glory. Give us eyes to pierce the veil, eyes to see transcendent beauty. God, the Lord who cannot fail, draw us closer by your Spirit till our hearts can bear no more. Gracious, patient, loving, faithful, Lord, your glory we adore. In Jesus' name and by his Spirit we pray. Amen. Sovereign Lord, we sing your glory. Yours is the eternal throne. The Mason family is now going to lead us in the singing of this wonderful hymn written by Peter James Ninnis. Let us praise God together.
Thank you.
singing of that beautiful hymn. Let's now turn to the Word of God, to Revelation chapter 4 and verse 1. After this I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice, which I had heard speaking to me like a trumpet, said, "Come up here, and I will show you what must take place after this." Once I was in the Spirit, and behold, a throne stood in heaven, with one seated on the throne. And he who sat there had the appearance of jasper and carnelian, and around the throne was a rainbow that had the appearance of an emerald. Around the throne were 24 thrones, and seated on the thrones were 24 elders, clothed in white garments, with golden crowns on their heads. From the throne came flashes of lightning, and rumblings, and peals of thunder, and before the throne were burning seven torches of fire, which are the seven spirits of God. And before the throne there was, as it were, a sea of glass, like crystal. And around the throne, on each side of the throne, are four living creatures, full of eyes in front and behind. The first living creature like a lion, the second living creature like an ox, the third living creature with the face of a man, and the fourth living creature like an eagle in flight. And the four living creatures, each of them with six wings, are full of eyes all around and within. And day and night they never cease to say, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." And whenever the living creatures give glory and honour and thanks to him who is seated on the throne, who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him who is seated on the throne and worship him who lives forever and ever. They cast their crowns before the throne, saying, "Worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honour and power, for you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created." Sometime after the vision of the opening chapters, John receives a second. He sees a door standing open in heaven, and he is summoned by the Lord Jesus Christ to come up that he might be shown a panoramic view of world history. He sees the entire period between the first and the second coming of Christ. And he does so from the vantage point of the throne of heaven. Behold, a door stood in heaven with one seated on the throne. God is the sovereign God. He is at the center of world history. And the central truth that we want to see and learn this morning is that God is on the throne. God is on the throne. And what a wonderful truth that is. And what a God, what a wonderful God he is. He is indescribably awesome and majestic. Notice that John speaks of him having the appearance of jasper and carnelian. Like Ezekiel before him, who spoke of the appearance, of the likeness of the glory of the Lord, John is simply dazzled and awestruck. He is in the presence of the God of the universe. Earthly kings could acquire precious stones only through international trade. But the heavenly king owns everything. The rainbow, with the appearance of an emerald, points to his covenant mercy. The flashes of lightning and rumblings and peals of thunder to his dangerous holiness. And the crystal-like sea of glass to his saving power. The seven torches of fire, representing the Holy Spirit, remind us of the Old Testament temple, the earthly dwelling place of God the King. Here in Revelation, we see the heavenly temple, the true temple, and in this temple, God is on the throne. The opening words of Psalm 99 capture all this beautifully. The Lord reigns. Let the peoples tremble. He sits enthroned upon the cherubim. Let the earth quake. The Lord is great in Zion. He is exalted over all the peoples. Let them praise your great and awesome name. Holy is he. God is on the throne. And the great throne is encircled by 24 lesser thrones, upon which are seated 24 elders. They are angelic beings who represent the entire church, the whole company of the redeemed. And the four living creatures, as Ezekiel chapters 1 and 10 make clear, are cherubim who represent all of creation. Echoing their song in Isaiah chapter 6, they ceaselessly say, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." They give glory and honor and thanks to the one who lives forever and ever. They cast their crowns before his throne, praising him as the great King of all creation, the mighty sovereign over all things. God is on the throne. Sometimes, perhaps often, everything in our world and in our lives may appear to be out of control, but God is in control. God is on the throne. Just as the hustle and bustle of an airport looks entirely chaotic until you go up into the control tower, even so, the unfolding of world history looks chaotic until you go up into the control tower of heaven, until you go into the throne room of heaven and see that God is in control and see that God is on the throne. Let's pause to pray together. Holy, holy, holy. All the saints adore thee, casting down their golden crowns around the glassy sea. Cherubim and seraphim falling down before thee, which wert and art and evermore shall be. Amen. Holy, holy, holy Lord God Almighty, the Ag family will now lead us in the singing of one of the most beautiful hymns, surely, in the history of the Christian church. Let us praise our triune God together.
Holy, holy, holy.
us in the singing of that beautiful hymn. Revelation chapter 5 and verse 1. Then I saw in the right hand of him who was seated on the throne a scroll written within and on the back, sealed with seven seals. And I saw a mighty angel proclaiming with a loud voice, "Who is worthy to open the scroll and break its seals?" And no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth was able to open the scroll or to look into it. And I began to weep loudly because no one was found worthy to open the scroll or to look into it. And one of the elders said to me, "Weep no more. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has conquered so that he can open the scroll and its seven seals." And between the throne and the four living creatures and among the elders, I saw a lamb standing as though it had been slain, with seven horns and with seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent out into all the earth. And he went and took the scroll from the right hand of him who was seated on the throne. And when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each holding a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song, saying, "Worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain. And by your blood you ransomed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation. And you have made them a kingdom and priests to our God, and they shall reign on the earth." Then I looked, and I heard around the throne and the living creatures and the elders the voice of many angels, numbering myriads of myriads and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing." And I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea and all that is in them saying, "To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever." And the four living creatures said, "Amen." And the elders fell down and worshipped. Have you ever wondered what it would be like with no Jesus? Have you ever wondered what it would be like without him? Well, to put it bluntly, there would be no hope. No hope for the church. No comfort, no deliverance, no new creation. The very thought of there being no one worthy to open the scroll and to break its seals is enough to make John weep. Because the scroll written within and on the back represents, as in Ezekiel chapter 2, God's master plan for his church in his world. As the commentator William Hendrickson put it, the closed scroll indicates the plan of God unrevealed and unexecuted. To open that scroll by breaking the seals means not merely to reveal, but to carry out God's plan. Who is worthy to open the scroll and break its seals? The voice cries out. Who is worthy, that is, to reveal and to carry out God's master plan for his church in his world? John's destiny here hangs in the balance. Our destiny here hangs in the balance. Who is worthy? Who is worthy to reveal and to execute God's master new creation plan? Who is worthy? Praise God. Jesus. Jesus is worthy. One of the elders says to John, "Weep no more. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David has conquered, so that he can open the scroll and break its seals. Jesus Christ, the Lion promised in Genesis 49, and the root heralded in Isaiah chapter 6, is the worthy King. He is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. He by whom and through whom and for whom all things were created. And he has conquered. He has conquered sin and Satan. He has vanquished death and hell. He has overcome every obstacle in the way of God, magnifying his grace and his justice in the salvation of his people. He has conquered. And he has done so in the most remarkable and surprising way. Between the throne and the four living creatures and among the elders, John sees him. He sees not a warrior, but a lamb. A lamb standing as though it had been slain. A lamb. And a sacrifice lamb at that. The mighty Lion is a sacrificial lamb. He has conquered by the blood of his cross. As his seven horns and eyes show, Jesus is perfectly worthy. And so we're told he went and took the scroll from the right hand of him who was seated on the throne. From this moment on, the moment of the coronation of the crucified, risen and ascended Lord Jesus Christ, the throne is the throne of God and of the Lamb. God has highly exalted him and has given him the name that is above every name. God has seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. What is the result? A collective sigh of boredom? I don't think so. No, an explosion of praise. Three great doxologies are sung to his everlasting renown. The four living creatures and the 24 elders take the lead. The other angels, then, unable to resist, then join the heavenly chorus. And finally, the entire created order erupts in worship. The triune God, and specifically the Lamb, is the applauded one. The four living creatures say, Amen. The elders fall down and worship. And we are left in no doubt that the throne rules, that the Lamb wins. With no Jesus, the present and the future would indeed be bleak. But Jesus lives. Jesus is on the throne. In the wonderful words of the Ugandan bishop quoted by Richard Hughes in his little commentary, the man of Galilee has not vacated the throne. The man of Galilee has not vacated the throne. Satan can roar like a lion, but he has no authority to shake the throne on which Jesus is sitting. The Lamb wins. God is on the throne. Shall we pray together? Crown the Saviour. Angels crown him. Rich the trophies Jesus brings. In the seat of power enthrone him. While the vault of heaven rings. Crown him. Crown him. Crown the Saviour, King of Kings. Every tongue and tribe and nation, worthy the Lamb. Join to sing the great salvation. Worthy the Lamb. Loud as mighty thunders roaring, floods of mighty waters pouring. Worship, at his feet adoring, worthy the Lamb. Lord Jesus, you are worthy. Worthy to receive all the adoration, worthy to receive all the blessing, worthy to receive all the worship there is to give. You are worthy. And we praise you. And we love you. And we adore you. Amen. Hear the church triumphant singing. We are going to be led in the singing of this beautiful hymn written by John Kent by the Fraser family. Hear the church triumphant singing, worthy the Lamb. Say with a voice like thunder, "Come." And I looked, and behold, a white horse, and its rider had a bow, and a crown was given to him, and he came out conquering and to conquer. When he opened the second seal, I heard the second living creature say, "Come." And out came another horse, bright red. Its rider was permitted to take peace from the earth, so that people should slay one another, and he was given a great sword. When he opened the third seal, I heard the third living creature say, "Come." And I looked, and behold, a black horse, and its rider had a pair of scales in his hand, And I heard what seemed to be a voice in the midst of the four living creatures saying, a quart of wheat for a denarius, and three quarts of barley for a denarius, and do not harm the oil and wine. When he opened the fourth seal, I heard the voice of the fourth living creature say, come. And I looked, and behold, a pale horse, and its rider's name was Death, and Hades followed him. And they were given authority over a fourth of the earth, to kill with sword, and with famine, and with pestilence, and by wild beasts of the earth. When he opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of those who had been slain for the word of God and for the witness they had borne. They cried out with a loud voice, O sovereign Lord, holy and true, how long before you will judge and avenge our blood on those who dwell on the earth? Then they were each given a white robe and told to rest a little longer until the number of their fellow servants and their brothers should be complete, who were to be killed as they themselves had been. When he opened the sixth seal, I looked, and behold, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth, the full moon became like blood, and the stars of the sky fell to the earth as the fig tree sheds its winter fruit when shaken by a gale. The sky vanished like a scroll that is being rolled up, and every mountain and island was removed from its place. Then the kings of the earth, and the great ones, and the generals, and the rich and the powerful, and everyone, slave and free, hid themselves in the caves and among the rocks of the mountains, calling to the mountains and rocks, fall on us, and hide us from the face of him who is seated on the throne, and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of their wrath has come, and who can stand? John now watches as the Lamb opens the seven seals. He now watches as the Lamb reveals and executes God's master plan for his church in his world. He sees the panorama of world history from the inside view, especially of the church. He is given an insight into the patterns and dynamics of world history, especially here in this vision, as they impact the church. The first five seals describe the experiences of Christians, especially throughout the entire New Covenant age. Throughout the entire period, that is, between the first and the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, while the sixth seal introduces the coming day of judgment. The opening of the seventh seal sees God appearing in judgment, but before it is opened at the beginning of chapter 8, we're giving a comforting vision of the safety of the church. As each one of these seals is broken, we're confronted again and again with the weighty truth that Christ is the sovereign Lord of history. He is in control. The opening of the first four seals sees the four living creatures, the cherubim representing creation, summoning four horsemen, like the horsemen in Zechariah chapters 1 and 6. Some hold that the Lord Jesus himself is represented by the first, but it's more likely that all four represent forces of evil. Forces of evil that are under the sovereign control of the Lord Jesus and used by him to punish unbelievers and, the emphasis in this vision, to purify believers. The first horseman, riding a white horse, has a bow, a crown is given to him, and he comes out conquering and to conquer. He represents conquest. Conquest through war, especially as it is experienced by Christians. The rider on the red horse, wielding a sacrificial knife, represents slaughter, bloodshed, especially the slaughter, the bloodshed of Christians. The rider on the black horse, meanwhile, represents the economic injustice faced, especially by Christians. Christians who refused to engage in emperor worship, knew by default exclusion from the trade guilds and therefore poverty. The unbelievers prospered while the believers suffered. The fourth rider then, on the pale horse, represents death. Indeed, his name is death. And together, these horsemen represent all the experiences mentioned in Ezekiel chapter 14, verse 21, namely war, famine, pestilence, and attacks by wild beasts. These are evil forces affecting everyone, especially Christians. The focus of this vision. But over even these evil forces, Christ is there. Christ is in control. Christ is on the throne. The opening of the fifth seal then brings back into view those portrayed in the opening of the second, namely those who have been slain or slaughtered for the word of God and for the witness they have borne. The martyrs of the church are particularly here in view, of course, but in a sense, everyone who has taken up their cross and died in the Lord. Their prayer is somewhat haunting. O sovereign Lord, holy and true, how long before you will judge and avenge our blood on those who dwell on the earth? They pray out of a concern for God's honor. They want to see his name vindicated and his righteousness displayed. As William Hendrickson put it, in slaughtering them, the world has scorned him, and they want to see him glorified. The Lord tells them to rest a little longer until all his people are saved. But how encouraging this must have been to John's readers. Some of their family members and friends have been martyred. And where are they now? Well, they're standing in the Lord's presence, dressed in white robes, alive and well. The opening of the sixth seal then introduces the coming day of judgment. God is poised to appear in wrath. Six natural phenomena are mentioned: the shaking of the earth, the darkening of the sun, the reddening of the moon, the falling of the stars, the vanishing of the sky, and the displacing of the mountains and islands. Six classes of men also are listed. All are affected. All try to hide from God. All cry to the rocks and mountains, fall on us and hide us from the face of him who is seated on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb, for the great day of their wrath has come. And who can stand? These are fearful events, but let us remember, it is the Lamb who is opening the seals. It is the Lamb who is governing the universe in the interest of the church. The rider on the red horse is given a sacrificial knife and permitted to slaughter the saints. The rider on the pale horse is given a limited authority. What we're being told here is that for the church, All these tribulations work together for good, for they come ultimately from the hand of one who is good. Listen again to William Hendrickson on this. True, it is the wicked world, and it is persecuting the church. But that world, in turn, is but an instrument in the hand of the one who has taken the scroll. So Satan is foiled by his own weapons. That which was intended as a means of extermination becomes a means of strengthening the church, an instrument for the furtherance of the kingdom of God and the salvation of his people. God is on the throne. Shall we pray together? Using the words of Psalm 94. O Lord, God of vengeance, O God of vengeance, shine forth. Rise up, O Judge of the earth. Repay to the proud what they deserve. O Lord, how long shall the wicked, how long shall the wicked exult? Blessed is the man whom you discipline, O Lord, and whom you teach out of your law, to give him rest from days of trouble, until a pit is dug for the wicked. For the Lord will not forsake his people. He will not abandon his heritage. For justice will return to the righteous, and all the upright in heart will follow it. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the truth of these words, and we make these words in these moments our prayer. How long, O Lord? All our hope is in you. All our trust is in you. We look to you. We trust in you. We hope in you. And we leave in your hands all our concerns. In Jesus' name and by his Spirit we pray. Amen. How long, O Lord? The Smith family are now going to lead us in the singing of this beautiful song written by Sovereign Grace. It really is a beautiful song, and let's be encouraged to listen and to sing together as we are led by the Smith family.
Sorrow, pain, and wrong. kingdom sits with your eternal King. How long, O Lord, how long? All our hopes are fixed on you, and your promises are true, and one day so we long to see your face. Until then, our hearts will burn. How long, O Lord? How long?
Revelation chapter 7 and verse 1. After this I saw four angels standing at the four corners of the earth, holding back the four winds of the earth, that no wind might blow on earth or sea or against any tree. Then I saw another angel ascending from the rising of the sun, with the seal of the living God. He called out with a loud voice to the four angels who had been given power to harm earth and sea, saying, "Do not harm the earth or the sea or the trees until we have sealed the servants of our God on their foreheads." And I heard the number of the seal, 144,000, sealed from every tribe of the sons of Israel. 12,000 from the tribe of Judah were sealed. 12,000 from the tribe of Reuben, 12,000 from the tribe of Gad, 12,000 from the tribe of Asher, 12,000 from the tribe of Naphtali, 12,000 from the tribe of Manasseh, 12,000 from the tribe of Simeon, 12,000 from the tribe of Levi, 12,000 from the tribe of Issachar, 12,000 from the tribe of Zebulun, 12,000 from the tribe of Joseph, 12,000 from the tribe of Benjamin, were sealed. After this I looked, and behold, a great multitude that no one could number, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes, with palm branches in their hands, and crying out with a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God, who sits on the throne, and to the Lamb." And all the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshipped God, saying, "Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, "Who are these, clothed in white robes, and from where have they come?" I said to him, "Sir, you know." And he said to me, "These are the ones coming out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will shelter them with his presence. They shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more. The sun shall not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb in the midst of the throne will be their shepherd. And he will guide them to springs of living water. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. The great day of their wrath has come. And who can stand? Who indeed? It is a pressing question. When God comes to judge, when the Holy God comes to judge, and he is poised to do so, who will be able to stand? Will the church be safe? Well, we find the answer in chapter 7, this moving interlude between the opening of the sixth and the seventh seals. John sees four angels poised to unleash God's judgment on the world, and then hears another angel telling them to hold back until the servants of our God are sealed on their foreheads. The seal, as in Ezekiel chapter 9, is a mark of God's protection, God's ownership, God's certification. I'm going to quote Hendrickson again because his words are beautiful. The Father, speaking of the believer, the Father has sealed him. For the believer enjoys the Father's protection throughout life. The Son has sealed him, for he has bought and redeemed the believer with his own precious blood. The Spirit has sealed him, for he certifies that we are sons of God. We're sealed. And John hears that the number of those sealed is 144,000. A number that, as Richard Bewes rightly says, is stylized. It signifies the company of God's people across the centuries. The whole company of the redeemed. Old and New Testaments. Perhaps what we have in this list is an echo of the census of the fighting men in the book of Numbers. A little hint, perhaps, that we're seeing the church militant on earth, in the thick of the battle, yet completely safe. From verse 9, then, we see the church triumphant in heaven. The focus seems to be on the church triumphant now, even now, in these moments before the Lord's second coming. But her completed glory at his return surely also is in view. John sees a great multitude that no one could number. No one, that is, of course, except God. From every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, in holiness and in happiness, they sing the praises of God and of the Lamb. But what an encouragement this must have been to John and to his first readers and hearers. And what an encouragement surely this is to us. Many of us will have lost family and friends, perhaps even recently. We know that they were believers. Well, this is their present experience. This is the present experience of our family and friends who have been called home. And one day, if we are believers, it will be our experience also. The words with which the apostle closes chapter 7 are so overwhelmingly beautiful that as we close, we'll hear them again and let them speak for themselves. These are the ones robes, coming out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will shelter them with his presence. They shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more. The sun shall not strike them, nor any scorching heat, for the Lamb, in the midst of the throne, will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. The Lamb wins. God is on the throne. Shall we pray? And there we'll find our home, our life before the throne. We'll honor him in perfect song, where we belong. He will wipe each tear-stained eye. As thirst and hunger die, the Lamb becomes our Shepherd King. We'll reign with him. Hear heaven's voices sing. Their thunderous anthem rings through emerald courts and sapphire skies. Their praises rise. All glory, wisdom, power, strength, thanks, and honor are to God our King, who reigns on high forevermore. O God our King, to you we give praise today. To you we give thanks today. You are on the throne. The Lamb wins. O Heavenly Father, may this glorious, may this awesome hope be the hope that carries us through this life into the next. May this hope carry us full sail into the ocean of glory. May your people rejoice that you are on the throne. May your people rejoice that the Lamb wins. In Jesus' name and by his Spirit we pray. Amen. We're now going to be led in the singing of the beautiful song written by Keith and Kristyn Getty, by the Heart family. There is a higher throne. Let's praise the Lord together.
Sun.
us in the singing of that beautiful song. I hope that you have found this time helpful. I hope that you have enjoyed the Word of God. And I hope above all that your hearts will rejoice today in the truth that God is on the throne, in the truth that the Lamb wins. I'm going to close with the benediction and doxology written for us by the Apostle John in Revelation chapter 1. Grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of kings on earth. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood and made us a kingdom, priest to his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever.